Let's turn back to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, where we're at the end of chapter 3, but I am going to forewarn you. We're going to focus primarily on verse 17 this morning, and then next Sunday we're going to focus on verse 18. There's just so much material that really we want to recognize, okay, as we are trying to conclude here in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. But I'm going to pick up. Let's just read verses 17 and verse 18, all right? 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So we have already dealt with what's going on in the immediate context, the issue of the veil, the covering that Moses had, the great lawgiver to the nation of Israel. The Apostle Paul contrasts his ministry as plainness of speech. There is no obscurity today. The Apostle Paul is not concealing any information, whereas the veil typifies and symbolizes the concealment. There were things that Moses did not know. There were things Moses could not know. And if we, and we already did look at some things in the Old Testament, it had various types and shadows and figures, and the information was not very clear. Moses hides his face to hide the fading, failing glory that was on his face. And so again, there's a lot of typology, there's a lot of symbolism, and certainly Moses did not receive the completed revelation of Almighty God. His revelation, the information that he was given by God, was of course very limited, very restricted, so on and so forth. So with all that said, we're going to pick up here at verse 17. Notice verse 17, the very first word, now. That's a Paulism. When you read Paul's epistles, quite often he will use the language now or but now. So what Paul's doing here, obviously, is he's contrasting his ministry. If you go back and glance at verse 12, seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. So what Paul is communicating is, hey, listen, now we know some things. Why? Because God has revealed some things. So when Paul begins verse 17 and he uses this time label, he's referring to what it is the Lord has taught the Apostle Paul. Now, in light of Pauline revelation, now in light of present day doctrine, the present day dispensational program that is operating, okay? So let's appreciate verse 17. Now the Lord is that Spirit. Well, what's Paul talking about? Well, if we glance back to verse 3, when Paul refers to that Spirit, remember how he started the chapter. We read there at verse 3, for as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart. So when Paul says, now the Lord is that Spirit, he's referring to something very specific. And I know often, and it's okay, you know, this is a verse that is used to defend the deity, the triune nature, the Godhead. Of course, we recognize there are three members, three persons of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And without question, you can use 17 as a proof text that, listen, when you're referring to God, the Holy Spirit, and you're referring to the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, well, yes, they're one and the same, and yet they are unique and distinct. But the purpose in verse 17 is not to prove or to affirm or to defend the Godhead, okay? I'm not saying you can't use verse 17, but the thrust is a little more specific, okay? In light of the context, the ministry of condemnation, the ministry of death. So what Paul is doing as he ends chapter 3 is he's taking us back to verse 3, and what he is focusing in on is the issue of God the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of the living God. And that's the issue here. The Lord is that Spirit, and there is this unique correlation between God the Holy Spirit and the living God. When you study the person of the Holy Spirit, when we study the ministry of God the Holy Spirit, you will find over and over again this link or this correlation to life, whether it's spiritual life, whether it's functional life, or even ultimately resurrection life. The Holy Spirit is attributed with the issue of life. So that's what Paul's really dealing with here, okay? So let's just recognize that in God's Word, we find this correlation between the Holy Spirit and life. We can go back to Job. Let's go back to Job and notice there at verse 33. Again, just recognize that there is this special ministry that is conducted by God the Holy Spirit that has to do with the issue of life. Now, we know Jesus Christ. He's the source, cause, and means of eternal life. But God the Holy Spirit is the agent that imputes that eternal life, okay? Again, Christ is the cause and the means and the origins. He's the basis by which God could ever give eternal life. But when it comes to the spiritual mechanics, God the Holy Spirit is the one who imparts that eternal life to the believer. In Job chapter 33, notice there at verse 4, the Spirit of God, this is a reference to the Holy Spirit, hath made me, and the breath of the Almighty hath given me what? Life. So even, and of course, Job predates the majority of the Old Testament. I mean, you know, we're talking Job knew some things about creation, so on and so forth. So even as early as the book of Job, we recognize the issue of the Spirit of God is linked to the glory of having life. Now let's go over to the book of John, and we go to John chapter 6, and we read here. We're just sort of scanning the passages dispensationally in John chapter 6, and notice there at verse 63, it is the Spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, and they are life. Just notice the correlation between the Spirit and life. Now let's go to Romans chapter 8. This is ultimately what the Apostle Paul is doing when we read, for example, in Romans chapter 8. We're introduced, by the way, to the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the book of Romans here in chapter 8. Now, he's referred to in chapter 5, but there's a reason why Paul does what he does in chapter 5. It isn't until Romans 8 that we're introduced to the ministry of the Holy Spirit. What is the ministry of the Holy Spirit? Romans chapter 8, verse 2. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. Remember this verse when we go back to chapter 3 of 2 Corinthians, verse 17. Paul's going to declare, now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what? Liberty. So we'll have a better understanding what's Paul talking about when he refers to liberty in connection to the Holy Spirit. Well, Romans 8, verse 2, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. And you remember what we saw in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, the law program, it served as a ministration death. It served the ministration of condemnation. And so Paul is emphasizing what it is we now have because of the ministry of the Holy Spirit, which has everything to do with the impartation of life. Drop down to verse 10. Notice that verse 10. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Back in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul talks about the ministration of condemnation. That's the old covenant program. But now the Lord is that Spirit. What Spirit? The Spirit that imparts life. The Spirit that frees us from sin and death. The Spirit that is life because of righteousness. Whereas the old covenant program, all it did was serve up condemnation. You know what the Spirit, God the Holy Spirit, serves up? He serves up righteousness. And that's the thrust that Paul is making, okay? In fact, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. When we were here, you know, a couple of years ago, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And again, we want to recognize this correlation between the Spirit and life. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, notice there at verse 13, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been made all to drink into one Spirit. The language Paul is using is very clear here. To drink into one Spirit. What Paul's referring to is functional life. The idea of drinking. And by the way, if Paul says in 2 Corinthians 3 that the Lord is that Spirit, that Jesus Christ is that Spirit of what? Life, that Spirit of liberty, that Spirit of freedom. Here, the end of verse 13, we've been all made to drink into one Spirit. Well, that takes us back to chapter 10. Remember what we read in chapter 10, verse 4. Chapter 10, verse 4. And did, this is reference to Israel, and did all drink the same spiritual drink. Now, you recall what happened historically, right? You know, Israel typically murmuring, complaining, which is an interesting type of a believer today who has the audacity to murmur and complain. So what does God do? God says, okay, Moses, you hit the rock, and when you strike that rock, water's going to gush out. And you remember the history there, right? So what Paul does, he provides the antitype. Now, every time I use the word anti, what do most people think? You see, don't be afraid of the word antitype. Jesus is an antitype, which means he's the literal realization and fulfillment of the type, okay? But again, I know people say, how can you say Jesus is the Antichrist? I never say he's the Antichrist. He's the antitype. He's the reality of the shadow, okay? The shadow is a type. So Paul, he's demonstrating that the Lord Jesus Christ, he's the anti-type, the reality of the shadow, verse 4 of 1 Corinthians 10, and it all drink the same spiritual drink. Now, Israel physically, they drank literal H2O water. But Paul, his assessment, as he's amplifying the fulfillment, he calls it the spiritual drink. Keep reading. For they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was who? So wait a minute. Paul says they drank of that rock, and that rock is Christ. But in chapter 12, he says, you and I, as members of the living church, the body of Christ, we all drink from the same Spirit. So are we drinking from Christ or are we drinking from the Spirit? Yeah. The Lord is that Spirit. And when Paul here uses that language of drinking together by one Spirit, I hope you write down John chapter 7. Why is Paul using such language, John chapter 7? And we read here at John chapter 7, look there at verse 37, John chapter 7, verse 37. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and what? Drink. You know why Jesus has to say that? Because Israel nationally is dying of spiritual thirst, apostasy. He's the living, he's the antitype. Verse 38, he that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. We won't go there, but in chapter 4, verse 14, the verse tells us that's everlasting life. You drink of me, and out of your belly shall flow rivers of everlasting life. What he's talking about is functional life. God the Holy Spirit has a direct correlation to the issue of life, which is typified by this flowing, raging river of eternal life, functional life, the application of life. The Holy Spirit, now, verse 39, but this spake he of the who? The Spirit. So when Paul says we drink of the Spirit, in other words, the Corinthians, as well as you and I, by extension, the body of Christ, guess what? We get to drink functional life. The Spirit is all about life. Not just initial soul salvation, eternal life, but continue on the flowing, raging river of functional life. And that's what Paul's emphasizing with the Corinthians. We've all been made to drink together in this functional, abundant application of eternal life. But again, our point is, it's always the Holy Spirit that is directly correlated to and linked to the issue of life. All right? So let's go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And again, in the immediate context, wait a minute. The Spirit of the Old Testament, death. The Spirit of the Old Covenant, death and failure, fading glory. Again, not because there was anything wrong with the Ten Commandments, but the problem is it was weak in the flesh. Okay, always remember that. So going back to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17, now, again, that's a Paulism, the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what? Now, let's ask ourselves a question, because this is really a rather odd way of saying this. If I'm in the desert, and I'm dying of thirst, and I come across someone, and I say, I'm dying, and if this guy says to me, well, where David is, there is water, what would be your first thought? Where's David? So think about that for a second. So I'm dying of thirst. Well, where David is, I'm picking on you only because you're over here. Where David is, there is water. So I would immediately think, where's David? So Paul says, where the Spirit is, there is what? So what should we ask? Where's the Spirit? You see how Paul, if you read commentaries, whenever you come across some language that is a little bit, when I say odd, that sounds almost negative, but it's rather, wait a minute, where the Spirit of the Lord is. So what the verse is intended to provoke, well, think about that for a second. Where are you going to find him? Now, charismatics go bananas, okay? We're not going to take that route. So what we want to ask is, well, where is the Spirit? Because if you know where the Spirit is, there's going to be what? Liberty. If we don't know where the Spirit is, then what's the converse? What's the opposite of liberty? Enslavement. And in the immediate context, Paul's talking about the enslavement, the bondage, the yoke the shackle of the old covenant program, the law system. So it's important to ask the question, well, where then is the Spirit? Because if where the Spirit is, there is liberty, then the converse, well, then if I'm not where the Spirit is, then I'm a slave. I'm in bondage, okay? So let's just examine, where is the Spirit? The one verse that is absolutely clear, but we're going to look at some other verses. Go to Galatians chapter 5. And I just want to start here, and then we'll work backwards just a little bit. The Spirit is not in the law system. The Holy Spirit is not under the law program. And that's what Paul is going to highlight here. Galatians chapter 5, look there at verse 18. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the what? The law. That's exactly Paul's thrust in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 as he makes the contrast between the old covenant and the tables of stone and the letter of the law, that all it does is kill. It works wrath, as opposed to the Holy Spirit and the issue of life, functional life. Well, where is the Spirit? He's not back under that old program anymore. If you be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. So it's critically important to ask the question, where is the Spirit? The Spirit is not in the law program. When a Christian today reverts back to this legalistic way of relating to God, that's not where the Holy Spirit is. That's where the flesh is. That's where the works, that religious works, performance, management, way of living. But that's not the Holy Spirit. For anyone to suggest that, you know, if a Christian today places themselves under the precepts of the law, that God's going to bless you, well, the Holy Spirit's not there. You know why? There's no life in the law. The law worketh wrath. The law condemns. It's a ministration of death. If God the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, would he be operating under that law program? Absolutely not. We have liberty. We're free from the shackles and the bondage of that performance-based way of being accepted by God, which revolves around the merits and the works of our own flesh. Any believer today who's operating under the law principle is operating in the flesh. And by the way, that's exactly what Galatians chapter 5 is going to argue here, okay? For example, we should have read a little bit sooner, but let's look there at verse 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit. Okay, where is he? I want to know where he, as we think about 2 Corinthians, where the Spirit is. Walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit. Be careful here. Don't read it as though, you know, I'm always fighting with the Holy Spirit. By the way, if you fight with the Holy Spirit, who's going to win? You can't fight with the Holy Spirit. Well, my flesh is always lusting against. No, the principle of the flesh is contrary to the principle of the Holy Spirit. See, that's what Paul is saying. Don't even start fighting against the Holy Spirit. So just appreciate what Paul is saying here. Verse 17, for the flesh lusteth against the Spirit. The flesh does everything motivated by the lust, the motion, the emotions of sin, which were, well, we should read that. Keep your finger here. What do you mean lust? Keep your finger there in Galatians chapter 5. Go to Romans chapter 7. There is innately an instinctive desire. There is this inherent desire among humanity to gravitate towards a legalistic works performance system. And what the gospel of Christ, the gospel of grace proclaims is, you're going to die. You will die functionally. There is this twisted, perverted sense. And by the way, the masses of religion, they're consumed with making one presentable before God, earning God's love, earning God's value, earning God's respect, earning God's love. And they do so via this works way of approach. And the only approach God will accept is His Son and what He did on the cross of Calvary. And what God declares is, when I killed my Son, I killed your flesh, I killed the lust of the flesh, I killed the world, I killed sin. So for the believer to go back to the graveyard of human works and human performance, which is empowered by the law, it's to practice necromancy. God says, don't worship me in the graveyard. The law is in the graveyard. You know, Sherry and I, I passed the cemetery over here by Harper. I forgot the name of the cemetery. St. Michael. How can I forget the name? St. Michael the Archangel. And so you know what kind of a cemetery it is, right? St. Michael the Archangel. You know what it is. And so, I mean, I drive past it every day. And when, like, Mother's Day, Father's Day, Easter, what was the other one? And you know what you find? Man, there are people all over the place. Mother's Day, anyway, Mother's Day, that cemetery is packed. People bring picnic tables and chairs, and they're having a lunch. They got the flowers and all of that kind of stuff. And they're trying to resurrect something. I mean, obviously, don't get me wrong. I'm not suggesting they're trying to resurrect dead people. But wait a minute. Don't celebrate and don't worship the Lord in the graveyard of the law. That's what I'm getting at, okay? So anyway, Romans chapter 7, look there at verse 5. For when we were in the flesh, the motions of sins, which were by what? Man, that's quite a sobering statement. The motions, and the word motions, we add an E to it. You know, we have e-commerce, we have email. I mean, we're not talking electronic motion, but just add an E to it, and you have the word emotion, the motions, the lusts, the desires of sin, which were by the law. Now, the law is not responsible for your sin, but the law principle, the works-based system of acceptance and seeking God's approval and so on and so forth. Wait a minute. The flesh is stirred up. The law agitates the emotions. And by the way, Paul later on, he says, it deceived me. See, the law in the lust and in the emotions of the flesh, the inner man delusion that I'll earn my way to God's favor. Paul says, wait a minute. Look at verse 6. But now we are delivered from the law, that being dead, wherein we were what? Held. You see that? Held. Bondage. The yoke. Imprisonment. Slave. We were delivered from the law. Why? So that we can be free from death. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So now go back to Galatians chapter 5 and verse 17 again. Galatians chapter 5, verse 17. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit. Again, the emotions of sin, the desire to earn something that God's never going to allow you to earn. And keep reading. And the Spirit against the flesh. There are two opposing principles at play here. Verse 17, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. Verse 18, but if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. So we know the two contrary principles works-based, flesh, emotions, lusts, desires, and then the spirit of liberty, the spirit of life. It's either one or the other. Where is the spirit? Let's go back to Romans, and let's go now to Romans chapter 8. Okay, Romans chapter 8. So, very good. Where the spirit is, well, I want to know where he is, because if I know where he is, then that's where I'm going to find myself. And what Paul's epistle says, well, you're not going to find the spirit under the law program. He is not teaching the believer the law system. He is not going to energize the law program. It's death, 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 death. Don't worship God in the graveyard. So Romans chapter 8, and we read verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the what? So are we going to find the Spirit energizing the law system? Never. But he'll energize the system of life in Christ, which results in righteousness. Verse 5, for they that are after the flesh, Paul's talking about the law, do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, where is the Spirit? The things of the Spirit. And we're, for sake of time, you continue reading Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8 is the introduction by the Apostle Paul to the church of the body of Christ regarding the work and the ministry of God the Holy Spirit. And the things that we learn is we have life in Christ Jesus and we're not under the law, and stop gravitating towards that death program, because that's all it engenders, is death failure because of the weakness of the flesh. Okay? So, going back to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And where the Spirit is, and we know the Spirit is not operating under that law principle anymore. So, obviously, Paul continues in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Now, the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what? Liberty. Now, in the immediate context, obviously, we're free from the letter of the law. We're free from the spirit of death. We're free from the death, administration of death. We're free from the fear. Why is it that Moses had to put that covering over his face? Because the nation of Israel, they were terrified. Well, we're free from the fear, the bondage, the spirit of bondage, where we fear, all right? We're free from the condemnation. We are free from that ignorance and the concealment and the limited knowledge. Paul says, I speak with great plainness of speech. So there is liberty. We have freedom. And if you study the issue of freedom in the Holy Spirit, we learn some wonderful truths. We are free from some things. We are free to some things, and we are free in some things. And that's what the Holy Spirit is all about. When we grasp the magnitude of the grace principle, which operates by faith, which is founded upon our complete identity and standing in the Lord Jesus Christ, everything we ever need is found in him, and it's available through the cross of Calvary. When we recognize that, wait a minute, the Spirit is all about freedom. And I've got lists. What are some of the freedoms that we have? And what are the freedoms that the Holy Spirit wants us to enjoy? Well, obviously, we're free from the law. We're free from the self-life. We're free from conditional acceptance. We're free from the need to have the world's approval. We're free from the unrealistic expectations that not only the world imposes, but we impose upon ourselves. We're free from the vain successes and desires and the vain ambitions and the need for validation. We're free from the need to have fame and fortune and popularity. We're free from having reputation. We're free from all of that. Why? Because we're free in Christ. We're free in His righteousness. We have freedom in His life. We have freedom in His hope, His glory, His adoption. We have freedom in His wisdom, His plans, His purposes. So when we study liberty, and by the way, we're free to fail. We're free to hurt. We're free to learn. We're free to be weak. We're free to struggle. We're free to doubt. We're free to question. Again, the Spirit is all, it's okay. But we're free to rejoice. We're free to relax. We are free to learn. We are free to grow. In spite of all of that, we will always be forever loved, valued, and adored by our Heavenly Father. That's what the Spirit's trying to drill into my thick skull sometimes. For me to wallow in shame and guilt and a sense of low worth, that's the law principle. Why would you think that way? In Jesus Christ, how can you ever view yourself as lowly and as unworthy and as unacceptable? You see how the flesh and the motions of sin and the lust and the desires, listen, it's contrary to what the Spirit's doing. It's easy to fall victim to such destructive thinking. That's not where the Spirit is. The Spirit's not about all that. The Spirit is all about leading the believer to this deep, rich, comprehensive understanding that you're already blessed, you're already loved, and don't go back to the flesh to try to earn something you can never earn. All right, so again, when we think about liberty, man, that's what grace is all about. We're free. We're free to be conquerors in Him. We're free to triumph in life. But we're also free, as Paul, I don't want you know, sometimes when we think about liberty, we have this idea that, you know, we are this poster child of spirituality where it's nothing but unending rejoicing and joy and confidence. Don't fall victim to that. We are free to fall down and bruise our knees. We're free to fall down in the mud because I'm still loved and adored and valued and esteemed by Almighty God. Now, the way we respond, what I'm getting at is go to chapter 4 very quickly, chapter 4, verse 8. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down. Are you free to be cast down? Absolutely. I'll never forget, lady, she was going through some really difficult, horrific things. And I remember one day she said she was guilty. And she didn't say that, but I knew what was going on. She was guilty. She says, you know, sometimes all I want to do is scream and shake my fist to God. And you know what? I said, go, do it. And she was rather, you know, she thought that's sinful to yell and to shake because she was angry. And not that any of us ever got angry, right? Yeah. Because of the persistent problems and issues and pain and difficulties. And you know what? She started sort of focusing on God. She's angry at God. And she was feeling guilty. There was this load of shame. And I said, go ahead, yell. You think God is going to be upset and He's going to get His feelings hurt because you're yelling at Him? I said, yell all you want. He'll still listen to you. He still loves you. It'll make you feel better. And so it was interesting. You can almost see the weight. She needed permission to yell at God. And I don't want you to think goofy things here. but it's okay. Paul was cast down. You're free. You're free. You're free to feel bad and down. But that's okay. Don't let it overwhelm and crush you. Tribulation worketh. Okay, now we need to understand something here. The Spirit, where is the Spirit? Well, tribulation, this is where the Spirit is not where the tribulation is intended or designed to destroy. You know where the Spirit is? When there is tribulation, when there is infirmity and persecution, so on and so forth. You know where the Spirit is? Working. Tribulation worketh patience. Patience, experience. Experience. So listen, our God's a good God. You can yell all you want. It's not going to change Him. It'll maybe, you know, you can vent a little bit. But just remember, where is the Spirit in all of this, okay? So, enough said. Verse 18. Now, what we're going to do in verse 18, we're going to ask three questions, all right? Verse 18, but, obviously contrast, okay? But, well, that's in contrast to verse 7. Let's glance back up to verse 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 7. But if the ministration of death, written and engraven in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly, notice, behold the face of Moses. So now, contrast, drop down to verse 18 again. But we all, not like Israel, we, body of Christ, but we all, with open face, not like Moses, who had the veil over his face, and then eventually Israel had a veil over their heart, okay? But we all, body of Christ, with open face, as in a glass, beholding, you see, that's in contrast to verse 7, right? All Israel beheld was the face of Moses. And that, and we already said this, what happened to that glory? It began to end. It began to fade away. And that glory, it struck terror in the hearts of the nation of Israel. So much so, they're saying, cover it up. Contrast. But we all, with open face, no reservation, no intimidation, no worries, no fear, no doubt. You know what? Father, expose the glory of your Son, Jesus Christ, okay? But we all, with open face, beholding, verse 18 says, as in a glass, the glory of the Lord. Contrast, Israel, time past, they beheld the glory of Moses. And they beheld, and again, the typology and the symbolism and so forth, that had everything to do with the impartation of the law, which ultimately fades away, it's inferior, it's death, so on and so forth. Wait a minute. But we all today, now, verse 17, now, guess what? With open face, beholding as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by, here we go again, the Spirit of grace, the Spirit of faith, the Spirit of liberty. If you're going to go back to that law principle, you're not going to see the illuminating, dazzling glory of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, because that's not where the Spirit is. What we're going to do is we're going to ask three questions, okay? Number one, how do we see this? Number two, what do we see? And then number three, what's changed? Okay, we're not going to answer all three. We're only going to, I hope, answer the first question. How do we see what's going on? What exactly is Paul talking about? Now, the idea of beholding, in a glass, that's the how. How do we see this glory of the Lord? We see the glory of the Lord by beholding as in a glass. Now, the word behold, we appreciate the Old English. I love the Old English, okay? And it doesn't say looking in a glass, does it? So the point is behold carries a little bit of a more meaning than merely looking, okay? Be, that prefix is the intensifier, hold, grasp, seize, apprehend. What Paul is saying is, listen, you know what we're supposed to do? You want to see the glory of the Lord? We need to pay strict, careful attention. We want to apprehend and grasp what it is about the glory of the Lord, okay? So we behold. That's a beautiful old English word that we don't always use on a daily basis. But anyway, we behold in a glass. What Paul is referring to here is the means of revelation, the means of discernment, the means of perception, the means. What the issue of beholding in a glass has to do with the entering in of a realm of understanding, a realm of discernment, a realm of knowledge, okay? I want to say this because there is no mysticism. There is a lunatic, charismatic group out there. They actually use verse 18 to justify visions and dreams. Now, so pretend you're one of those. How would you read verse 18? If you believe in visions and dreams, read verse 18. But we all with open face beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord. So what do these people do? They believe they see the glory of the Lord. They see the face of Jesus in dreams and in visions. Is that what Paul's talking about? Is Paul using the beholding as in a glass? Is this a proof text for supernatural visions of Jesus? I got to tell you a funny story. Back in Pennsylvania, I got into hunting, okay? I've never hunted before in my life, but I really enjoyed it. I like small game hunting. Anyway, so here was this old timer. He wanted to take me hunting somewhere out there in the middle of rural Pennsylvania and so forth. And so I'm trying to get to know the guy, okay? I asked, okay, hey, tell me, whatever his name was, Charlie. So, Charlie, how did you come to know the Lord? You know, give me your testimony. I want to know, how did you get saved, right? So he got a little quiet. We're walking along, and he says, well, one day I saw Jesus, and he said something. And you know, I kind of giggled. I thought he was joking, okay? I saw Jesus, and he told me something, right? And so I said, okay, no, really, really, how did you come to know the Lord? And he looked me dead in the eye, and he said, I saw Jesus, and he spoke to me. And then it was like, he really believes this. We're both carrying shotguns, and I'm like, I don't know if I want him behind me. I'm just kidding when I say that, right? So long story short, listen, Paul is not suggesting that there is some mystical connection, some supernatural world that we tap into where we see the face of Jesus, beholding as in a glass. Now, in the context of 2 Corinthians, we're going to get an idea. What is this issue of beholding in a glass? Notice in chapter 4, let's just drop down to chapter 4, verse 3. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds. Now in chapter 3, verse 14, Paul's talking about how Israel is blinded, okay, because they don't believe. So verse 4 again, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God. So wait, if Paul in chapter 3, verse 18, starts talking about a glass that enables the believer to behold the glory of the Lord, which results in being changed in the same image, Paul's telling us it's the glorious gospel. The glorious gospel reveals the light. By the way, you can't see anything in a mirror if there isn't any light. A mirror, by the way, is living. You know, maybe Kyle, if he wants to, how do I look? And he takes a picture of himself 20 years ago. And he says, man, I look pretty good, right? Well, a picture's dead. A picture only captures an image that was made in time past. A mirror is living. You know what I mean when I say the mirror itself isn't alive. But if you're looking at an image, it's real time. It's the real deal. Sorry, Kyle. Don't look at the 20-year-old dead image. You look at something that's happening today. So Paul is using, he's going to develop it. That's what I'm getting at in chapter 4. He's going to develop some things here. Listen, that glass is the means of revelation. And Paul, he talks about this gospel. He calls it the glorious. Why does he call it the glorious gospel? This is the glorious information and news concerning the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the image of God. Verse 16. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of who? Jesus Christ. Now let's read chapter 3, verse 18 again. But we all, with open face. Well, wait a minute. Paul's going to talk about the face of Jesus, not in this weird mystical vision. The face of Jesus Christ, and it's through this light of the knowledge of the glory of God. So here's what we're going to, how do we see this glory? We see it through a glass. That glass is a representation of the gospel. It's a representation of the knowledge of the glory of God. There's nothing supernatural. There's nothing mystical. There's nothing subjective. It has to do with this system of information that reveals the glorious truth regarding the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The issue of glory and the issue of knowledge. This is something, go back to Romans chapter 1, over and over again. We find, and by the way, I'm sure you're familiar with James chapter 1. We'll go over there. James chapter 1. James, he correlates the glass with the Word of God. So again, the Bible is going to reaffirm there's a connection between the glory of God and the knowledge of God. So if Paul's using language, I behold in a glass, and I'm going to behold the glory of the Lord, he's talking about because of doctrine that has been communicated. Notice in Romans chapter 1, verse 22. Look at Romans chapter 1, verse 22. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. Now notice, who changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image. Question, how do you change the glory? By the way, you know, I've said this before. Can you make water any more wet? No. How can anyone change the glory of God? Now, we're focusing in on 2 Corinthians 3. I want to be able to behold in the glass, the means of revelation, the glory of the Lord. So Paul, he takes us back into history. Verse 23, they changed the glory of the uncorruptible God. Wait, how can anyone change his glory? What's Paul talking about? Drop down to verse 25. Who changed the truth of God into a lie. So when Paul says they changed the glory of God, they did it by changing the truth. In fact, if you glance back up to verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. So to change the glory of God is to lie about him. You change the truth of God, you're changing his glory. I want you to think about that for just a second, because go to Romans chapter 16. There is, in one of the societies of Roman Catholicism, there's a motto. And for the life of me, there is a local Christian school, Protestant. They have the same motto on a banner. The motto is, and it's Latin, I'm going to probably mispronounce it, Ad Maiorem Dea Gloriam. Translated, for the greater glory of God. And that sounds admirable, right? For the greater glory of God. And yet, I know something about what they teach. They change the truth of God, and they lie. The issue of the glory, and what I'm getting at, Romans chapter 16, verse 27, to God only wise be glory. We can't escape the truth here. The glory of God is intimately connected to the truth. And if you manipulate the truth, you're changing the glory. You're changing what it is God is making known about himself. And next week, specifically, what God the Father wants the world to know about his Son. And if you're lying about it, you're changing his glory. You can't change him in his person. We understand that. But we can change the world's perception of what he's doing. And you know, you got to appreciate verse 27, to God only wise. You see the issue of wisdom? It's the revelation of his program, the revelation of his purpose. In fact, look there at verse 25. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, there's something revealed about the Son. When Paul says that God today, he is making known the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The Father is revealing some things. Moses didn't have a clue. Israel didn't have a clue. Paul says, we now, with great plainness of speech, we know something about the face of Jesus. That is the purpose, the eternal place that the Father has destined his Son to have, and by way of default, his body, the church. That's the glory of God. And for a ministry to deny the unique purpose and place that the Father has given to his Son, revealed via the mystery which was kept secret since the world began. You're lying about him. Do you see how serious this is? The glory of God is still an issue today. How are people going to know who he is, what he's doing? For any ministry that denies the place that the Father says, I've given to my Son, and you keep him in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you're lying about what God's doing. You're changing his glory. That is a sobering, serious issue. Again, not to pick on any, ad maiorem Dea Gloriam. And yet they call us a cult because we talk about the heavenly places. We talk about this church, the body. There's only ever been one church. If you believe there's only ever been one church, you're lying about what God's saying. You're changing his what? That's not to the greater glory of God. You're demeaning his glory. So we'll end there, okay? We'll pick up next week three questions. How do we see this glory? What is it we're going to see? And what are the ramifications of seeing it? And that's what Paul's going to get at, all right? Father, again, we thank you for your grace and for your goodness. We thank you for your word. And as always, may we hold it in highest esteem and allow it to effectually work in us as we believe it to be the truth. And we ask it all in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.